Good morning and welcome. I am Joanne Jessen, a member of the Board of Trustees at the Unitarian Universalist Church in Reston. We are so glad you are with us this morning. No matter how old or how young you are, wherever you are on your spiritual journey, however you identify, and whomever you love, know you are welcome here. We hope that you were able to join the wonderful Christmas Eve service on Zoom, led by Reverend Scott, with Reverend Julie Price, Cynthia Young, and the choir, plus other musicians, Linda Weaver, Jesse Leong, and so many others working behind the scenes. Thank you all for making it happen. I hope that you all saw the numerous announcements that were on the scroll leading up to the service. Our service today is being led by Cara Fortner. Cara joined UUCR in 2012 with her husband, Jesse. Since that time, she has served in many capacities, including as a member of the church board, chair of the worship committee, and as a member of the choir. We are very pleased to have Cara here today leading this service, which she has titled, Living Simply and Giving Generously. We are also joined by member Meagan Potluck-Schmitt, who is our guest accompanist today. Music director Cynthia Young and Linda Weaver, our director of religious education, are not here today. They helped plan today's service, and you will see Linda in the Time for All Ages video she prepared. Bob Anthony is serving as our worship associate, and Holly Anderson is serving as chat usher today. We are also joined by guest musicians Jeff, Julia, Jeremy, and Jill Loewer. Jeff and Jill are UUCR members, and we are grateful to the Loewer family for sharing their musical talents with us today. Ron Bracey, David Nemi, Mike Schmidt, and Amelia Turner are running the technical side of service. Thank you all for participating in today's worship. Now, let us center ourselves for worship. Please take some deep, quieting breaths. Let us enter our time of worship together and enjoy Children's Song Number 1, composed by Chick Corea and performed by Jeff Loewer on the vibraphone. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Good morning and welcome to this worship space. I am so glad to be here with you all this morning, even if most of us are virtual. I do have this amazing skeleton crew here with me this morning. I'm glad to be making this service happen with our amazing volunteers. This entire service is completely volunteer-led. As Joanne said, it is Cynthia did a whole lot of work to help us prepare for today, and Linda offered also a time for all ages. But I am grateful to be here once again in this pulpit. It has been a while since I've been in this pulpit, so I'm glad, very glad to be back here. Our staff also had to make the Christmas Eve service happen, and that service required a lot of pivoting. And we do keep needing to pivot, don't we? This pandemic has kept us on our toes for so long now that I think most of us have come to expect that our plans are really more like hopes, and they may or may not quite happen the way we want them to. It requires energy to keep this up, and I know I am tired, and I can sense that others, many of us, are feeling tired as well. But we are blessed in this moment to be able to share this space and this time. And this specific nebulous moment of the year, the time between Christmas and New Year's, the time where we are allowed, almost unable to escape the slowdown, the halt after shopping, cooking, wrapping, card making, card sending, present sending, parties planned or attended, the chaos is now ended. Let us appreciate this moment. Today, over the course of the next hour, you will hear three different stories, starting with this excerpt from The Practices of Love by Kyle David Bennett. One time, Socrates was having a conversation with a man named Glaucon. They were discussing what it takes to make a just city. They were thinking along these lines: what if we started all over again and were able to build a city from the ground up? What would it take to make this city just? What would it take to make this city good? What would we have to do to get the people to live rightly, as they should, and help them find happiness? What kind of education would we need to institute? In general, what sort of things could we do without? Long before they got to the kind of education they would need to make the citizens learn and value good character, they began discussing what everyone would need in this city. Certain material goods and resources would be essential to make such a city. Socrates began by saying that food, shelter, and clothing would be all the people needed to survive. Glaucon scoffed at this notion and told Socrates that they were building not a city for pigs, but one for human beings. Glaucon claims that having only food, shelter, and clothing was too austere and simple for human beings. You might as well put them in a sty and throw in some mud. Glaucon believed that human beings need more refinements and comforts than food, shelter, and clothing. If anything, those are assumed basics. They are the essentials of the essentials. But human beings need more. Glaucon then started to enumerate to Socrates these essential amenities. Some of them were the equivalent of couches, tables, delicacies, cosmetics, courtesans, actors, poets, and gold and silver. Glaucon's argument is that human beings need these things. We cannot and should not get rid of them. At the heart of this discussion is a deeper, nuanced conversation about the nature of luxury and lavishness. Is there a difference between living comfortably and living excessively? Or are they one in the same? Is it possible to live comfortably without living excessively? Or must we own more than we need in order to do so? Can we find luxury in having nothing? Can we find luxury in living simply? Or related to this, does living elegantly require us to live extravagantly? In order to be stylish, sophisticated, and dignified, characteristics befitting a human and not a pig, according to Glaucon, do we have to own a lot of really expensive stuff? Or can we find elegance in simplicity, or even austerity? Please join me now, if you are at home, in singing our opening hymn. It's A Gift to Be Simple, number 16. Thank you. Number 16. And we'll sing it through twice.
Paper, I managed to grab the wrong one. Today's chalice lighting words are by Jay Woolen. Two hands gracefully reach upward, palms open and fingers relaxed. Are we a people holding on or letting go? Holding on to rigid ideas or letting go to opening our minds and our hearts to something new? Holding on to certainty of how things should be, or letting go and living with the uncertainty of new ways of being in the world. Holding on to what makes us comfortable, or letting go so we may grow, which can be uncomfortable. Holding on to what makes us safe, or letting go to make room to help others feel safe. With this flame, this symbol of our religion, let it be a symbol of burning up the ties that hold us back from being our true self and reaching our true potential. Let it be a symbol of lighting a new way for us into a better tomorrow. And let it be a symbol of letting go. Because holding on too long and too tightly is never good for the soul. Each week, our congregation recommits to one another by singing our covenant. Please sing along with our congregation's video. For those joining us for the first time, please take this as our blessing.
Morning. When I heard the theme for the service today, I thought of a story that I first read in Lynn Unger's program, Sing to the Power. It's about a real family, the Sawins, who lived in Atlanta, Georgia. When Hannah was 14 years old, she was sitting in the family car at a stoplight with her father. When she looked at one side of the road and noticed a homeless person holding up a sign asking for help. On the other side was a Mercedes. Hannah thought aloud, why does that person in the Mercedes have to drive such an expensive car when the money could go to help the homeless person have enough food to eat? Her father said she had a good point, but their car was more expensive than most people could afford. Well, Hannah kept thinking about this. She had been thinking about injustice and inequality for a long time, and so she brought this question to her family. Why do we have more than enough when other people don't have nearly as much? Her parents first answered by pointing out some of the things they already did. They volunteered for Habitat for Humanity. Her mother had given up a high-paying business career to become a teacher. Their family together delivered food with Meals on Wheels, and the children were required to keep one-third of their allowance to buy groceries for the homeless. Weren't they already doing enough? Then, Hannah's mother, Joan, said, what should we do? Sell our huge historic mansion and give away the money? And Hannah loved the idea. She said, yes, that's exactly what we should do. We should sell our house, buy one that's half the size, and then give the difference in the money to charity. Well, this family had weekly meetings where each person had an equal vote. And from then on, the family started talking about this idea. Hannah's brother Joe couldn't figure out why they'd ever want to get rid of their wonderful big house. And Kevin and Joan, their parents, thought long and hard about what this might mean to the family finances or money. But Hannah kept pushing, and finally the family agreed to sell their home. And they also agreed on what to do with the money. They decided that their money would make a bigger difference if they gave it to a group in Africa. And after a lot of research, they chose the Hunger Project, which helped villagers in Ghana help themselves. This got a little harder than they expected when their $1.9 million house would not sell for nearly that amount. But with the sale of their house and the sale of the rights to a book about their experiences, they were able to raise the $800,000 they promised to the project. The book that Kevin and Hannah wrote talked about how they made this decision, about their trip to Ghana to see their project, and it also talked about how this project made a difference in the family's life. As Kevin said at the end of a TED Talk that he and Hannah gave together, we traded in stuff for togetherness and connectedness. Now, you might be wondering how this relates to your life, because you might not be able to do something like this, sell a house and for a lot of money and buy one that's half that size. And Kevin said, that's not what they were encouraging. But if you think about it, you might have something that you could give half or even a small portion of. Maybe it's daily coffee for adults, or toys, or books, or clothes. Think about what you might do and what difference it could make in someone else's life and in your own.
Story. That was the second story of the three that we'll hear today. Now we've reached the point in our service where we invite you to consider your joys and concerns. You are welcome to write it in the chat. Please know that what you write is public. And if you are able to light a candle in your own home, if you would like, please do. Go ahead, Jeff. This morning, we have many concerns and joys, starting with the joy of being with one another over the holidays. There are health concerns for many, and for those on the mend, we are grateful. For Holly's niece and nephew going through a hard time, Brittany and Blake, we pray for you. To Janetta and Todd, who just got married recently, joyous occasion, and happy birthday to Elaine and to Carol. and for the joys that come with just the knowledge of a new day. Congratulations on new jobs and on new beginnings as we enter a new year. May there be many new blessings that we get to experience. We continue to pray for the Afghan refugees who continue to enter our country. We continue to pray for the spiking red zones around us from the Omicron variant. We pray for our health and for the health of those around us. We pray for more and more people to continue to get vaccinated and to continue to live safely so that we can continue to do our best to keep the spread of this COVID-19 virus down. For all these things, the things that we share together and the things that we keep in our hearts, we say amen and blessed be.
We now invite you to support the work of UU Reston by making your donation to our collection plate at the link on the slide and in the chat box. Thank you for your generosity and support of our beloved spiritual home.
Stormy winds made moan. Earth stood hard as iron, water like a stone. Snow had fallen, snow on snow, snow on snow on snow. Bleak midwinter, long, long ago. What can I give you, poor as I am? If I a shepherd, I would bring a lamb. If I were a wise man, I would do my part. Yet what can I give you? Give my heart. Snow had fallen, snow on snow, snow on snow on snow. In the bleak midwinter, long, long ago.
Thank you, Julia and Jeff. That was beautiful. Started crying. I'm like, no, I can't do that yet. I have to read. I will start this sermon, as I start every sermon, with gratitude. Anytime I have ears that are willing to listen to my words and that might affirm my place in this sacred position of in the pulpit, a position that was not allowed to a woman in the tradition in which I was raised, I am grateful. I appreciate that our faith allows and encourages my voice and other lay voices in this pulpit. And as I am working towards becoming a minister in our beautiful faith tradition, I will continue to uphold this practice and appreciation. Our voices matter. Your voice matters. It is no small thing that is part of our culture to openly question and acknowledge our limited understanding of nature, reason, God, and all things. And for this allowance, this permission, I am grateful. I appreciate everyone joining us this morning and giving this space and these words your attention. We are together right now, whether physically or virtually, together in the hope for a movement of our spirits in the direction of peace and compassion. In this search we conduct, I feel compelled to take a moment and consider the weight and true importance of material wealth, especially in light of this global pandemic and the economic repercussions of it. Wealth can bring us comfort, and like the opening story it discussed, it can, with Socrates and Glaucon, it can bring us luxury. But the story also asked us to consider how, if we can find elegance in simplicity or even austerity. I think to answer that question, we must acknowledge that it is possible, but it most certainly will require concerted intention and effort to make simplicity elegant. For some of us, this comes more naturally, as we have had mothers who clip the coupons from the Sunday paper, or we have a dedicated ambition to give generously of ourselves, of our time, for the benefit of others. Frugality can be a spiritual discipline, just as living generously can be. Both, however, can be accomplished without spiritual intention. But when we do cultivate a certain depth to the way in which we interact with our worlds, we can achieve so, so much. As I mentioned earlier, we hope for the movement of our spirits in the direction of peace and compassion, but these are simply wonderful aspirations that we hope to achieve. We are led then, if we are curious enough, to wonder how we actually can achieve these holy aspirations. How can we be at peace when our spirits are tied up in obsessions? How can we be at peace when we are comparing ourselves to others, thinking in some way that we are lacking if we don't have what others have? How can we have compassion if we can't find peace for ourselves? What gets in the way of peace? What gets in the way of your peace? I think peace is often blocked by envy, and our attachments to material wealth is an enormous source of envy for many of us. How many times have we heard a story about or a study about that says that people who earn an income beyond a certain bracket are less happy, less satisfied with life than those who earn a more modest income? Is there something contagious about having money, a need to have more of it? What about the stories about people who win the lottery? They're marked by suicide, depression, and often mismanagement of their funds that end up putting them right back in the poverty they began in. What is life worth? How can we put a price tag on how we live? Are we fated to just want more? It would be wrong to deny that comforts and luxuries are nice. Have you had the Cioppino at Lake Ann Wine Bar? Anyone here? Anyone been to Lake Ann Wine Bar? I have just a few here, so I don't put too much pressure on you. But it is delicious. And it is expensive. Good things are worth enjoying. They are worth making, and they are worth getting paid well for. I am glad that the chef at Lake Ann Wine Bar took the time to learn how to make a beautiful meal. And I am glad that they have sourced their ingredients and brought them in far from the sea. Material delights are not evil. It took me 7 hours to make a beef bourguignon for my husband's birthday 2 weeks ago. And that time commitment and the resources I used, that was worth creating something delicious that brought people around to a table in celebration of my dear partner. There is no part of us that should stop loving and appreciating the finer things we may find ourselves lucky enough to enjoy. There are dangers, though, in not appreciating what we have. We may have thousands of dollars in the bank and still feel the need to hold on to it because of the uncertainty of the future. I am here to tell you that what we need truly is very little. Maybe more than Socrates suggested of clothing, food, and housing. Maybe Glaucon was onto something by including actors, poets, cosmetics, and delicacies. The arts and aesthetics of life, which we carry with us everywhere, is not something I would throw away with ease. These things can be achieved through the human spirit, though they do also often require funding. It is a tough balance to try and achieve. Finding a balance between generosity and gratitude, between giving and receiving, between taking care of ourselves and taking care of others, balancing the physical, emotional, and spiritual needs of others and ourselves is no easy task. Giving generously to that which we care about is not always easy. We can feel limited and strongly possessive of our time, our resources, our energies. We may find, though, that the more we allow a peaceful movement of our spirits in this practice of life, that we are able to loosen our grip on things and ideas that hold us back. This semester, I've been studying at Wesley Theological Seminary, and the experience has been very healing for me. Learning in a liberal and progressive Christian school has shaped my heart in a new way with regard to how I see Christians and the one they call Christ. Jesus, especially in the Synoptic Gospels, Mark, Matthew, and Luke, talks about the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. And while that phrase carries some heavy words that I definitely have bias towards, I have come to understand through my study that this kingdom is God's utopic vision for us, for all people, not in some afterlife, but right here, right now, in our physical spaces. As Unitarian Universalists, the kingdom of God is defined for our understanding as our sixth principle, the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. From the Gospel of Luke, there's a story about a man named Zacchaeus. And I was hoping there would be more because I have interactions here with people. But does anyone here know the name of Zacchaeus? Yeah. So it's only really in the Gospel of Luke. For those of you who don't know, I'm going to read it to you. It is from Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. And this is from the New Revised Version of the Bible. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not. So he climbed up a tree, and Jesus was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to that place, he looked up and saw Zacchaeus and said to him, "Hurry down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it grumbled and said, "He has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and save the lost." There are a lot of details and a lot of things to unpack in this, but I want to center in on a few. The term salvation here is critical, as we are called to consider that salvation means that Zacchaeus is now seen and included in his community, because he is given the opportunity to share that he has intentions of doing good for the poor and those with whom he interacts daily in his role as a tax collector. Zacchaeus seems to be saved for being seen for who he is, a generous man, rather than who he is perceived to be, a sinner. Zacchaeus was on the margins, and salvation came to him because he sought it. Zacchaeus is an example of how a person can make good money and enter the kingdom of God, the kingdom that is right now on earth, the kingdom that we define as our sixth principle, the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. It is easy to imagine how if more of those with wealth would share it more generously, that we would move in the direction towards an actual world community where the poor are liberated from their poverty and the rich are liberated from their own attachments, and both meet from their extreme places from outside the margins. I am compelled to think of enormously wealthy folks like Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk, who have way more than any one person or household needs. I saw a meme once comparing billionaires to real-life dragons sleeping on piles of hoarded gold and jewels. I think it is an apt comparison. I can only imagine how having so much wealth could corrupt a person's spiritual dignity, making them imagine that every bit of it is theirs to possess, even when it could feed, clothe, and house others who have nothing. Or better yet, like Glaucon suggests, maybe even the poorest of the poor might dare enough to hope for beautiful and luxurious moments, experiences, and things. I am also compelled to think of myself. My wealth, which feels like it is often not enough, but is still much more than most on this earth possess. I am being asked to consider how my wealth marginalizes me, keeps me from living into our sixth principle. Wealth is no small consideration. We have each grown up with some vision of success or understanding of value of money, and it is easy to stay flowing along a path that says, keep what is yours. But I wonder, how many of us with wealth still feel unvalued, still feel undefined, still struggle with pain, loss, depression, anxiety? And I wonder how living more simply and giving more generously might affect our spirits. I imagine it just might move us in the direction of peace and compassion. Please join me now, if you're at home, in singing our closing hymn, number 90. Let me pull it up here. Beware the worship of wealth, imagining it can give us wholeness, that it can give us contentment. We must balance this with the knowledge that luxuries are part of the beautiful experience of earth, an experience we should appreciate with depth, an experience we might notice not all are able to receive. I hope those of us with monetary wealth can be like Zacchaeus, prosperous and giving. And for those of us who may not have as much cold, hard cash, I would like to offer these words from the Dalai Lama. Giving material goods is one form of generosity, but being kind, attentive, honest in dealing with others, offering praise where it is due, giving comfort and advice when they are needed, and simply sharing one's time with someone. All of these are forms of generosity, and they do not require any level of material wealth. May the joy of simplicity and generosity move through each of us in beautiful and new ways. Amen.
drops on roses and whiskers on kittens, bright copper kettles and warm woolen mittens, brown paper packages tied up with strings. These are a few of my favorite things. Cream-colored ponies and crisp apple strudels, doorbells and sleigh bells and schnitzel with noodles, wild geese that fly with the moon on their wings. These are a few of my favorite things. Girls in white dresses with blue satin sashes, snowflakes that stay on my nose and eyelashes, silver-white winters that melt into springs. These are a few of my favorite things. When the dog bites, when the bee stings, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember my favorite things, and then I don't feel so bad.
We invite our congregants attending service on Zoom to join us for our virtual Greet Your Neighbors coffee hour today to discuss the service theme and enjoy fellowship with other congregants. The link is in the chat box. Also, please use the chat box as a virtual receiving line to leave a message about your appreciation for today's service. We wish you a blessed week and a joyful welcome to the new year, which we hope will bring us together in person once again.